Welcome to Lifeline Baptist Church, and thank you for joining us this Lord's Day as we worship God together. It's good to see you. I know that we have many that are sick and afflicted, and so we are so glad to have all of you with us today. Please make sure that you have your worship guide with you today. There are a lot of things going on. Some of them are out of the ordinary, so you'll want to remember that. Remember, following our services today, we will be feeding the family of Kelly Kemp at 12:15 in Fellowship Hall. And then at 2 o'clock today, we'll have a memorial service for Brother Kelly here in the sanctuary, and I hope you will be back for that and support this family. We buried him yesterday in Sheridan, and so please remember to be here this afternoon at 2 o'clock for the memorial service for Kelly Kemp. And then because of that, and because we have so many sick with COVID, we're not meeting tonight, so please remember that. Also, in your worship guide, remember that this week we have a lot of things going on, and Wednesday night we will have our business meeting. We were not able to do that last Wednesday night because we had so many sick. We will have business meeting this Wednesday night, and first we'll have our supper, and our Lifeline Cafe, they're doing a great job. Had one of our best meals last Wednesday night. This Wednesday night we're having chicken casserole, Brussels sprout salad, and dessert. And we're looking forward to that. Give our cafe a hand and thank them for preparing our meal. Also, let me remind you that coming up and up here at the prayer stations, there are these information sheets about our church-wide Sunday School Teachers Appreciation Dinner on Wednesday night, August 17th. Notice a time change. It's going to start at 6. So we want everybody to eat with us as we recognize all of our Sunday school teachers. And we're going to have roast beef with gravy, cream potatoes, green beans, salad, and strawberry shortcake. And so we're going to have a good time. And so please sign up for that. And that's up here. And so pick that up. Place that in our offering plates today. When you can pick those up in just a few moments when we move around and greet one another. Also this week we have YOY potluck on Thursday. A lot of things going on. Next Sunday deacons meeting, promotion Sunday's coming back, and so we're going to have a good time. It's good to see you today. Stand up, greet one another, move around, and pick these up and sign up for our 17th banquet, and then we'll come back and worship the Lord together. The Bible says in St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 24, verse 30, "And then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with great power and great glory." Matthew 24, 30. Listen to these scriptures again. "And then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with great power and great glory." Let's sing, "These Are the Days of Elijah." Brother Clay.
Darkness. Jehovah. There's no God like 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 Jehovah. Behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation. The King is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see.
Through the Psalms today, we're reading in Psalm 86, a psalm of supplication and trust, a prayer of David. And he says this in these first seven verses: Incline your ear, O Lord, and answer me, for I am afflicted and needy. Preserve my soul, for I am a godly man. O you, my God, save your servant who trusts in you. Be gracious to me, O Lord. For you I cry all day long. Make glad the soul of your servant. For to you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. For you, Lord, are good and ready to forgive, and abundant in loving kindness to all who call upon you. Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer, and give heed to the voice of my supplications. In the day of my trouble, I shall call upon you, for you will answer me. We live in a day of trouble where people are hurting physically, mentally, and spiritually, where people have lost loved ones, and people are going through great sickness, and we hear of one thing one right after the other. But we know that God is on his throne, and we know that God is the great creator, the great Savior, and the great doctor of all the ages. If you believe that, say amen. Amen. And you can look around and you can tell that we have many that are sick and afflicted, and we get that. We realize that there are multitudes of people that are struggling, but we lift our voices in one accord. Today, as Pam begins to play, I'm just going to ask you, as we bow our heads and close our eyes, if you know of somebody sick or afflicted, would you hold up a hand in their honor? Just hold up a hand in their honor. I'm going to ask you, whether you're seated or would you come to the altar and pray for these that are sick and afflicted, would you move out now? Whether you're in the altar or you just are seated, would you pray for these that are sick and afflicted, and some are coming? Let's give these things to the Lord and call their names out before God. Thank you. God, in Jesus' name, I pray that you would hear our prayers as we pray all over the sanctuary today. As you've called us to be a house of prayer, I pray that we would pray to the God of all the ages, the great healer. God, I pray that you would bring physical and mental and spiritual healing to these around us that are sick and afflicted. And God, in Jesus' name, I pray that you would be with us as your church, that we would be the salt and the light that you've called us to be in a lost and dying and very dark world. God, speak to us now. God, I pray that you'd be with our mayor as he leads our city, our governors. He leads our state, our president, as he leads our country once again. He's gone into quarantine and we lift him up. And we pray, God, in Jesus' name, that you would bring healing, physical, mental, spiritual healing to this country, that we would wake up, we would realize that we need great revival, and that revival is only going to come into you. We praise you and worship you because we know that one glorious day we're going to worship you for eternity. In Jesus' name we pray. You may be seated. Brother Clay is going to come and lead us as we sing One Glorious Day.
Rising again, living he loved me, dying he saved me.
And I believe he's coming back. If you do, give the Lord a hand and thank him that one day he is coming back. Today our ushers are going to rise and we're going to receive our tithes and offerings. We're going to listen to God. They will even wait to come in until after we've received our tithes and offerings. We want to hear God. Thank you for giving online, on site, bringing it in and mailing it in, because we've had so many sick and God just continues to bless. And so we want to give back to God today. Let's pray together. Ron Ogle, voice our prayer, please, sir.
Our Father and our God, I thank you so much for everything you do for us. And Lord, the way we start each service, singing these beautiful songs to uplift the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, we love it. We love you. Lord, we love this church and hope the best for it. Help us, Lord, to walk with you each and every day. Let us be that light that we need to be to show a dark world who we are, that Jesus Christ lives within us. Lord, I pray for Brother Jeff today as he brings our message. Lord, I just pray the power of the Holy Spirit will fall all over him. God, I thank you for this time of offering that we can give back to you the way you have richly blessed us this week. Lord, we love you. We want to serve you. Forgive us of our sins in Jesus' name. Amen.
Nothing's going to get you excited today. Give our pianist another hand and thank her for playing that. Today, our children's church is getting ready. Miss Sherry and those children that are with us, you come. Our children went to camp this week, and we are glad that they did. And we're being cautious with all the sickness. Give all of our beautiful boys and girls a hand and thank them for being with us today. Miss Misty is going to come and lead us as we continue to worship the Lord together.
Took your thorns to crown me with grace. It took your nails to pierce through my shame. It took your stripes to heal all my pain. It took your last breath to empty my grave. Only your love could ever done, done. You crush the voice of every fear. Shield me from arrows when they appear. You have forgotten my every sin, and you remember the cross instead. Yes, you conquered death and hell, and you hold the keys. You release the prisoners. Prisoners are free. You have conquered death and hell.
Thank you, Miss Misty, for allowing God to use you, and thank you for sharing your talents with us. So thankful for our youth going to Siloam and for our children going to our family farm and all the workers that went with them. Give them a hand and say thank you to them for allowing God to use them. Make sure today that you have your Bibles open to St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6. Today we're going to begin reading verse 23, and we'll read down through verse 25. St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6, verses 23 through 25. Let me say to you today that as we look at God's Word together, I give you as much information before we stand and honor the reading of the Word of God as I do after. And both pieces of information are important to us. And so I want to remind you that that is true especially today as we study God's Word together. Let me also remind you today that on Wednesday, I lost my voice, late Tuesday and Wednesday. Thank God it's better. I've been tested 3 times this week for COVID and didn't have it. Say amen. And I'm not sharing that, but I want to be mindful that every day we're walking with people and we want to be very cautious. And so today I want to remind you of that with my voice, just in case I have to take a sip of water here in just a few moments. Let me remind you today that we've looked at Jesus and his Sermon on the Mount, practicing righteousness, from St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6, verses 1 through 34. Today we're going to begin the ending of this message, but it is a 3-part ending, and you won't get that all today. But however, I want to say to you today, we're going to begin to talk about anxiety. And today, if you know anybody dealing with anxiety, over the next 3 weeks, you need to have them in God's house, because God's Word speaks directly toward anxiety. And this is something that, as a pastor, that I deal with on a daily basis. And it's something that most of us as Americans deal with on a daily basis. And so we're going to see how Jesus transitions from wealth to anxiety today. Let me remind you of our biblical theme for July. And we look at that when we will start with the outline of practicing righteousness. Jesus on giving, Matthew 6, 1 through 4, on praying, 6, 5 through 13, forgiving, 6, 14 through 15, fasting, 6, 16 through 18, on treasures, Matthew 6, 19 through 21, on wealth, Matthew 6, 22 through 24. We will finish that up today and move to anxiety, Matthew 6, 25 through 34. Lifeline's 2022 July theme, Be Strong and Courageous, focused on the book. And it says this in Joshua 1, 8. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written within the book. Then July, Lifeline, July 3rd, of course, was God and Country. July 10th, Canon Sunday. Old Testament Canon Sunday was the 17th. On the 24th, New Testament Canon Sunday. And today, the church age, and we were going to have Lord's Supper. Because of COVID, we will postpone that. But today, we're going to talk a little bit about the church age. We are currently living in the church age. And let me share with you that we're closer to Jesus coming back than any other group of people have ever been. There have been times, no doubt, where groups of people thought, this is the generation, this will happen within my lifetime, Jesus will come for the church. And so we sang songs about the days of Elijah, the king is coming, even Misty's song, talking about the Lord. And we think about, is Jesus going to come back in my day and in my time? Well, we do not know. But it's safe to say that we have lived longer than any other age of people, and we're closer to the end of the age than any other age. Now, does that mean that Jesus is going to come back in your lifetime or mine or our little children? I just simply do not know. The Bible says that Jesus, the Son of God, doesn't even know. But when we think about the church age, we're reminded that that's the age that we're living in now. Number one, in the church age, we think about the Christ, Matthew 1, 1 through 21. Matthew 1, 21 says, And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sin. And so we understand that the church age begins with Christ. Even our calendar is based up on it. In fact, it used to say, today we would say today is July 31st, 2022, in the year of the Lord, because it is the year of the Lord, or the church age today, because supposedly less than 0.5% of the world, less than 50% of the world claim Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. Many no longer use that phrase, in the year of the Lord. But notice the church age begins with Christ, Matthew 1, 1 through 21. And then as you go back, you begin to think about the 12 disciples, the apostles, Matthew 10, 1 through 15. And notice that we understand that it gives us approximately, the apostle John was the last apostle to die around AD 95. And so you have the disciples or the apostolic age for the first 100 years of our calendar, roughly up until AD 95 or AD 100, depending on when the apostle John died. And so we see scriptures with the calling of the disciples, the apostles, in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 10, verses 1 through 15. Then number three, the New Testament canonization era. Matthew 1, 1 through Revelation 21, 21. And we know that it took roughly 95 years in that period of time from the crucifixion of Christ, the resurrection, around AD 33 to AD 95 for the Bible to be put together as we know it in the New Testament canon. And so when you look at that, that's also a part of the church age. And so we see that Matthew 1, 1 through Revelation 21, 21. We understand that the Bible is, or 22:21, Revelation 22:21, that the Bible is put together that way. And then the church age, from the Apostle John to the today. And so notice that the canon closed with the Apostle John, and there's never going to be another New Testament book written. And so you and I are in the church age from the Apostle John to today. And I'm never going to write a book that's going to be in the Bible. You're never going to write a book that's going to be in the Bible. And no one else is, because the canon has been closed. And by 1611, we have what we currently call the New Testament. and most of those Bibles consisted of the Old Testament canon and the New Testament canon. And so we see that a lot has gone in, but you and I understand that we are living in the church age. I am the church. Church is, as we've often said, not a place that we go, but the church is who we are. I am the church. And so we remind ourselves of Matthew 1:1 and Revelation 22:21. Notice the connection between these two scriptures. Matthew 1:1 and Revelation 22:21. 1:1 says, "In the record of genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David and the son of Abraham." That's the Old Testament canon coming to fruition in Christ. And then notice Revelation 22:21. "The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with all. Amen." And so we come from Father Abraham to David to Christ, and we understand that we're benefactors of that. We are inheritors of the gospel of Christ. The application of the church age in Jesus' Sermon on the Mount and anxiety. Now listen close. The application between the church and the Jesus' Sermon on the Mount and anxiety. What do these three things have in common? The church age, Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, and anxiety. What do these three things have in common? Why in the world would we talk about the Old Testament canon, the New Testament canon, the church age, and anxiety, and Jesus all together? Well, friend, let me say to you, if Jesus Christ is not the cure for anxiety, then there's probably not any cure at all. And let me say to you that if Jesus Christ is not the God of the ages, there's no hope at all. And if Jesus Christ is not the God of the ages, then there would be no reason for us to celebrate his life, his death, his burial, and his resurrection. But please notice these three connecting points and the application. When I'm preaching and studying the Word of God, I want to make application. Application number one. Jesus is the creator of the world, Colossians 1:16. Jesus is the founder of the church, Colossians 1:18. Jesus is the healer of the church, Colossians 1:22. Jesus is the creator, the founder, the healer. Creator, founder, healer. Say those three things with me, please. Creator, founder, healer. Say it again. Creator, founder, healer. Every church member, including myself, you and I will deal with anxiety one way or the other. Either my own personal anxiety or the anxiety of somebody around me. And let me say to you, anxiety is very contagious. We do not spread it from person to person, but we experience it when one person around us experiences anxiety. Almost every time, everybody in the house will experience anxiety as well. And so we need to understand he's the creator, he's the, notice this, the founder and the healer. Colossians 1, 16, 18, and 22 says it this way. Read with me, please. "For by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him." There's our problem. This is the source of anxiety, I believe, is that we do not realize we're created for him, and so we do many things against him. When you do not realize you're created for him, you do many things against him. Notice that it goes on, it says, "He is also head of the body, the church, and he is the beginning of the firstborn from the dead, so that he himself will come to have first place in everything." Second problem. He does not have first place in most of everything in our life. "Yet he has now reconciled you in his fleshly body through death in order to present you before him holy and blameless and beyond reproach." Most of us, not even on a Sunday morning, come before God holy and blameless and beyond reproach. In fact, it could be said that therefore are many of us that would never come before God holy and blameless and without reproach. And it's not our jobs to condemn one another, but to help each other to understand what it means to be the church. We are the church, the bride of Christ. And so please notice, the creation, the church, and all the people have been tainted with sin and sin nature. The creation needs a touch from Jesus. The church needs a touch from Jesus. I need a touch from Jesus. If you agree with that, say that with me. I need a touch from Jesus. Say it again. I need a touch from Jesus. Please rise in honor of the reading of the Word of God as we read from St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6, verses 23 through 25. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light that is in you is darkness, how great is the darkness? No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. And let me say to you this morning, please give me privilege. If you are trying to serve God and wealth, you will have great anxiety. If you are trying to serve God and wealth, you will have great anxiety. Now, I'll address where anxiety comes from in just a few moments biblically. Look at verse 25. For this reason, notice the connector. For this reason, I say to you, do not be worried about your life as to what you will eat or what you will drink, nor for your body as to what you will put on it. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Now, notice the connecting verses, verses 24 and 25. You cannot serve God or wealth. For many years in the New Testament, especially in the King James, we said you cannot serve God and mammon. But understanding that word to be wealth, and for this reason, there's great anxiety among you. We are double-minded, not only in most churches, in most homes, in most countries. We are double-minded, because we're trying to serve God and the world at the same time. Last week, before everybody came down with COVID, and I was teetering on losing my voice even then, I was going to have Brother Steve to bring in a sawhorse. And I was going to straddle that sawhorse and illustrate for you while I was preaching that it's difficult to have one foot in one world and one foot in another and try to do anything successfully. But that's what we're trying to do, not only in America, but the world. We want to serve God, and we want to serve the world, Satan. And we want to do it successfully, and we're never going to be able to. And we wonder why we're dealing with the things that we're dealing with now. I need a touch from Jesus. If you do, say it with me again. I need a touch from Jesus. God, speak to me and speak through me. May you be glorified in your worship service. This is the Lord's day. We are the church. This is the church age. Help us to apply your word in Jesus' name. God's people said, as you're seated, make sure that you leave your Bibles open. And again, let me say to you, today is the first of three messages on anxiety. And so as we think about anxiety and practicing righteousness, we're going to conclude verses 23 through 24, the practicing righteousness, wealth to anxiety. We've talked about the clear eye. Today we're going to talk about the bad eye and the two masters. Three things about the bad eye. What causes my anxiety? The bad eye. Notice that this is the word bad is the Greek New Testament word poneros. We get our English word, two words from it, evil and pornography. Evil and pornography. Please notice that in James 5:16 it says, confess your sins to one another for healing, for the prayers of a righteous man availeth much. For the effective prayers of a righteous man availeth much. And so we talk about eyes, ears, mouth, mind, hands, and feet. If you're not using your eyes, ears, mouth, mind, hands, and feet for God, there's going to be anxiety. Now, let me say to you, I am not a pastor that believes that anxiety is not a mental disorder. I do believe that it is associated with our mental disorders, but I do also believe that it's tied to sin nature, because I believe that all physical and mental ailments come because of sin. Hear me closely. I believe that all physical and mental ailments come because of sin. Not just because you and I have been in sin, but because we're born with a sinful nature, and it's passed down from one generation to the other. And I'm not saying that if you're struggling with anxiety today, it's because you have an unconfessed, unrepented of sin. I'm saying that all of our physical and mental ailments come from Satan and sin nature. If you heard that, even if you don't understand it, go ahead and hold up your hand. I want us all on the same page. And I want you to understand that when we're dealing with anxiety, it's not necessarily because of something that we're doing wrong or something that we're not doing right. It's because we live in a body that daily is being tainted by sin nature. Just like we live in a world that's daily being tainted by sin nature. And if you do not believe me, look at all the fires, look at all the floods, listen to the rain that was hitting the roof just a few moments ago. We live in a world that is being tainted by sin nature day in and day out. And that's why Revelation says that Jesus will one day destroy this heaven and earth, and that we'll have a new earth and a new heaven. He's not talking about a permanent address of God. He's talking about the first heaven, the sky up above us, because the earth is tainted by sin and sin nature. And so is your body, so is my body. My eyes, my ears, my mouth, my mind, my hands, and my feet. And I need the touch of God, because every day I'm dealing with that. So notice the bad eye. It is an evil eye. Now, I've been told that I can give an evil eye. Somebody said this week, they said, I was talking to them, met them at Starbucks, and they were laying on the line about some things going on in their life, making sure salvation, dealing with some things. And they said, well, undoubtedly I've made you uneasy. And I said, what makes you think that? They said, well, your eyes are going back and forth. I said, oh, don't worry about that. My eyes go back and forth all the time. Go ahead and say amen. Okay, that's how God made me. Now, God made me in this body, and daily this body's getting older, and daily this body's dying. One day I'm going to have me a brand new body, aren't you? And so we think about that we're being tainted with sin nature, and we think about the bad eye. Notice the bad, porneios. It comes from our English words, evil and porn. And then notice the bad eye makes the whole body full of darkness. And this is skotidanon, and it means darkness in the physical sense, the mental sense, and the spiritual sense. We live in a very dark world. But let me say to you that if you're not a Christian, then your darkness is going to keep getting darker. It would be like a person that was going blind. Their blindness would start gradually, and little by little, their eye would be full, a little dark. And then it would get darker and darker and darker until completely one day they could see nothing. For the lost person, that's the way the world is. For the Christian man or woman, then we understand that John says the world should be getting lighter. And so regardless of what the world is doing, what Satan is doing with death and sickness and sorrow, for the Christian, my world should be getting lighter. If you live in a world that's getting darker, there's a problem. And we need to talk about it. Now, notice the bad. The bad eye makes the whole body full of darkness. And then notice number three. The bad eye makes the light within you full of great darkness. Just when you think the darkness can't get any darker, then great darkness comes upon you. Notice in this passage of Scripture. Notice what he says in verse 23. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light that is in you is darkness, how great is the darkness? And you may be thinking, how great is my darkness going to be? I did not sign up for this. This is not what I thought life was going to be. And I can guarantee you, when I was 18 and God called me to preach, I had no idea that I'd preach through a pandemic. I had no idea that I would preach so many funerals. I had no idea that I would get to see so many people saved. I had no idea that God would call me to Lifeline Baptist Church. I had no idea that I was going to be married to my bride for 32 years. I had no idea. Has it all been good? No. Has it all been bad? No. But God is walking us through this. But friend, let me say to you, for those without Christ, the world's about to get mighty darker. Mighty darkener. Great darkness. The word mighty or great darkness means mega, mucho. It's going to be darker than what we can imagine. The only way we're going to make it through the darkness is with Christ Jesus. If you give Christ a hand and thank him for walking through this darkness with us. Notice what the Bible says in 1 John chapter 1, verses 5 through 7. This is the message that we've heard from him and announced to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus his son cleanses us from all sin. That's how we make it through the darkness. I need Jesus to touch me. Now notice the two masters, Matthew 6:24. You cannot serve two masters. Now this word serve is doulion, this word serve is a slave to two masters, doulion. You're either going to be a slave to sin or a slave to the Lord. And so please notice three things about serving two masters. You cannot serve two masters, number one. Number two, you will hate one and love the other. Number three, you will be devoted to one and despise the other. Now, I want to say something to you today, and I want to be very clear about this. People that are saved people, and they know the love of God. People that are not saved, that call themselves people of love, they do not know the love of God, because 1 John 4, 7 and 8 says, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. And I meet people all the time that seem to be loving people. There's a difference in being a loving person, because you experience God's love in a Romans 5, 8 way. God demonstrated his love toward us that while we're yet sinners, Christ died for us. And then John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. In Matthew 22:36-40, they came to Jesus and said, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? And Jesus said, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. This is the great and foremost commandment. The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. I hear people say this all the time. Well, I was in love with her. Or I thought she was in love with me. Please notice the difference. If you're a Christian, then you know the love of God and you can love somebody as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it as a husband. But if not, then you notice number three, there's a difference in loving God and being loved by God and then being devoted. And I think in the world that we live in, we've confused the love of God with devotion. Just because somebody's devoted to you does not mean that he or she is a Christian. It does not mean that they know the love of God. There's a difference in being saved and devoted. And friend, the world needs to know the difference in God's love and a devotion to the world. And the only way that you love God is because he first loved you and gave himself for you. But see, we get that all confused. And I think that that's why we live more by lust than by love, is because we think that devotion automatically means, well, he loves God, so he must love me, or he's a loving person. A lot of loving people, I'm afraid, are going to end up in a place called hell because they were not devoted to God, because they didn't love him, because they didn't bask in his love first. And so please notice the difference. And so I deal with people whose relationships have crumbled. The other night I got a text late in the night, and they said, well, late for me, I go to bed between 8 and 8:30. I don't go to sleep because my phone would go off, and that's a good thing because I want to minister to people. But here's the deal is I got a text that said, I need some advice. Can I text you? Then I got another text right after that, same minute, same time, 10:27. I know it's late. Can I text you? And then my phone rang. I didn't even have time to read the text until later. Okay? And they said they wanted advice on a relationship. And they said, I know that there's love. And I said, well, are both of you Christians? No. Then there's no love, because love is God and God is love. Say that with me. Love is God and God is love. And there's a difference between love and devotion. Now, I'm never cocky enough to say, well, I know who loves God and who doesn't. I know who's saved and who's unsaved. This group of people are going to heaven and this group of people are going to hell. God forbid, that is not my job. Go ahead and say amen. But we need to teach, especially our young people, between the difference, the biblical difference between God's love and devotion. And I think that a lot of anxiety comes from this fact that we cannot recognize God's love because we're so blinded by devotion that may be to the world and it may be to God. And we become lukewarm. And Jesus says that when we're lukewarm, when we're neither cold nor hot, we make him sick. I do not want to be a Christian man, a Christian husband, a Christian daddy, a Christian preacher that makes God want to puke. And I'm afraid we've got that going on in the world because we've not taught men and women what the difference is between love and lust and devotion to the world. Just because we're devoted to something doesn't mean that we're in love with God and that we've accepted that God loved us first. And so please notice the two masters, God and wealth, mammon. Notice the biblical application of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount and practicing righteousness, wealth. Number one, love the light of Jesus and serve God. Number two, hate the darkness and Satan and use your wealth for Jesus and God. Now notice number two. Notice what he says. We need to learn to hate the darkness. Notice what he says. We need to learn to hate the darkness and Satan. That doesn't mean that I hate people. I love God. And I love God's people. And I know that God created all people, and there's a difference in creating and saving all people. But I can't save them. And I can't tell you who's lost and who's saved, so I've got to love them. If you get that, hold up your hand. That's important. If there's hate within me, John says in 1 John, then there's darkness within me. And friend, let me say to you, if I could stand up here behind God's pulpit and tell you that I hate one human being, then I shouldn't be standing in God's pulpit. If you can sit in that pew and or online or on site and reason in your mind, I hate one person, then you better question whether or not you've experienced the love of God. Now, love and devotion are two different things. You can't love God and be devoted to the world because you're going to be on that sawhorse and you're not going to be able to get off. And so please notice what's going on in this text. I need to notice the two masters, God and wealth. I need to love the light of Jesus and serve God. I need to hate the darkness and Satan. And I need to use my wealth for Jesus and God. That's why Southern Baptists are the wealthiest group of people in the world. Because God gave it to us. But if we do not start using God's money, God's way, it will go away. If you get that, say amen. Now please notice anxiety. It is a Greek New Testament word, mormente. And as we study anxiety, we're going to look at three things over the next 3 weeks. Number one, the case of anxiety. Number two, the cause. And number three, the cure. And it's not on purpose, it's more on accident that they all start with the C. But notice the case, the cause, the cure. Now, let's talk about the case of anxiety. Matthew 6, 25, 30, and 34. What does it mean when somebody says, I have anxiety? It means, number one, that they worry. Matthew 6, 25. Number two, that they have little faith. Matthew 6, 30. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the furnace, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So if somebody says, I have anxiety, and they're a Christian, it means that they're worrying, that they have little faith. And notice 6, and notice this passage of Scripture. In verse 34. So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will take care of itself, for each day has enough trouble of its own. The case of anxiety is built around three words. Worry, actually four words. Worry, little faith, and trouble. Worry, little faith, and trouble. I'm not going to ask you if you're a worrier, because just about everybody that I know worries about something at some point or the other. If you're a Christian, little faith is not a problem unless, if you're a Christian, you have faith or you wouldn't be a Christian. If you get that, say amen. And the Bible says that you can move mountains with enough faith the size of the seed of mustard. If you're with me and you've heard that and you agree, say I do. So little faith is not a problem until fear overrides your faith. Fear overrides your faith. Now I have a comfortable car because God provides for me well through this church. Go ahead and say amen. The other day I was riding in somebody else's comfortable car that I didn't provide. And so it's more convenient and more comfortable than mine. Several other days, and it has this little thing on the seat, and I was driving down Rodney Perriman, Little Rock, and all of a sudden my seat started vibrating, and I thought, what in the world is going on? And I thought this comfortable, clean car was having a malfunction, and I realized that every time it went, it's because I crossed the line. And I wasn't supposed to cross the line, and it was telling me. Don't you wish that you had somebody on the person sitting next to you every time they crossed the line, you could go, and say, hey, wake up, you've crossed the line. Well, friend, when we worry, we have little faith, and we're about to be in big trouble. God's word is that it's going to tell you that you've crossed the line. Would you bow your heads with me, please, and close your eyes? Nobody's looking around. Heads bowed and eyes closed. The case of anxiety. The worry. The little faith. The trouble. The worry. The little faith. The trouble. The biggest problem with anxiety is for a world that does not know Jesus. If you're online or on site and you've never asked Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, then your world is as dark can be. And you've never asked Jesus, or you're not sure, would you pray a prayer like this? Would you say, Lord God, in Jesus' name, I'm a sinner. Forgive me of my sin. I want to be a Romans 10:9 Christian. I believe that God raised you from the dead, and I want you to be the Lord, the boss of my life from this day on. Save me. Cause me to turn from my sin. I ask you to be my Savior. I believe that God raised you from the dead. I confess. I believe. I'm calling on you right now. Save me. Save me. If you prayed that prayer today and you're in this house, would you lift your head and look into my eyes, please? Anybody, you prayed that prayer and you nailed down your salvation. You lift your head and look into my eyes, please. Thank you. Thank you for being strong enough to lift your head and say that prayer. We want to help you. We want to disciple you. Now I want everybody to look right here. If you know somebody today, maybe it's you yourself, you're struggling with either worry or you're struggling with little faith, or somebody's in trouble. You're struggling with that. You know that. That's all of us. Would you stand with me, please, and say, I know somebody that's either worried or struggling with little faith or in trouble. Everybody should be standing right now, because that's all of us. And if you don't, call me today and I'll share some first names and ask you to pray for some people. Brother Josh is going to come. Miss Suzette is going to come. Now for those that prayed and received Christ, Jesus said, if you're not willing to confess me before men, I'll not be willing to confess you before my Father who's in heaven. In just a few moments after we pray, we're going to ask you to come forward. If you prayed and received Christ today, you come forward. I know it's a lot to ask you to walk forward. You say, well, why do we do that? Well, Jesus walked up a hill for you called Calvary and died on your sin, for your sin. Now, I'm going to ask you today, if you know somebody struggling with major anxiety, would you bow your heads with me, please? Close your eyes. Nobody's looking around. You know somebody that's a Christian that's struggling with major anxiety. Would you hold up a hand in their honor? You know somebody that's lost, that's struggling with major anxiety. Hold up a hand in their honor. I'm going to ask you to pray, come to this altar and set the example for the person that got saved in the house today. And if you got saved, you come. Somebody will meet you here. But if you know somebody struggling with anxiety, would you step out right now and come and pray for them right now? Some are coming even before we start singing. God, speak to us now in Jesus' holy name. You come as the Lord leads you. You come. Brother Clay, lead us, please.
I've wandered far away from God. Now I'm coming home. The paths of sin to long.
You got saved and you need to come, you come. You're struggling, you need help, you need somebody to pray with you, you come. We're going to sing this invitation, then we're going to close.
Coming home, coming home, never more to roam. Open wide thine arms of love, Lord.
Brother Josh is going to hand this mic to Brother James. Brother James is going to close us in prayer in just a moment. See, he does, let me say this to you. If you're struggling with anxiety or you know someone is, do not beat yourself up and do not beat the people around you that are struggling up themselves. Let's walk through and help people get through their anxiety. Do not cause somebody anxiety. And do not beat yourself up for having it, because almost everybody is affected by it today. Okay? If you're a Christian, I want you to say, I belong to God. Say that with me. I belong to God, and He is enough. Say it again. And He is enough. One more time. And He is enough. Brother James, dismiss us in prayer. I want to see you back at 2 o'clock. Help us today with the Kemp service. Brother James, pray for us, please.
Amen. Father, thank you.
Tonight.